Welcome, everybody. Don't get rusty. March 24, 2022. It's a short title, but I'm going to read it anyway. Ask a CFI almost anything. Who knows why? Ask a CFI. I don't know why. Let's ask a CFI. All right. It's a short title. All right, let's move on. It's a long one, so we're going to keep this thing moving today. Moser.
I got it. I'm on it. Come on.
All right. Generously, as always, brought to you by the big three, or one under three, which is Boeing, ForeFlight, and Jepson. Thank you for them for helping us out. There it is. Okay. Quick, like we always do, the attendee control panel. So on the right side, that's how you ask your questions. You see the little, what is that? It's a bubble with three dots on it. So that's how you ask your questions. You don't ask them verbally. So we'll be keeping an eye on those notes. And then as things come up and they're pertinent to the conversation at hand or the question at hand, we'll just kind of throw them in there. And then just remember, we'll always be available for the last 30 minutes as question and answer. We'll try to cover everything else. But it's a big one today, so don't feel slighted if we don't get to you. Next. All right. So a couple intros. So I'm Pablo Morelia, Senior Director of Flight Training Technology for You Can Fly, AOPA Foundation. Flight training. Okay. Pilot, tech guy, animal guy, hockey player, up until recently when I hurt my knee, but we'll get that later. Maker of the app called AOPA Flight Training Advantage. Everyone loves it. And I know you will too. We'll get to that in some other webinar. Chris.
Here I am. I am work with AOPA, the Senior Director of Flight Training Education. And so, yes, I am a CFI. And I like playing music and skiing and all kinds of good stuff. But more importantly, I'm here today to help out. Just my main goal is to help out schools. And we've got our flight school connector. So if you know of any flight schools or any types of flight school management that might be interested, tell them to check out our monthly webinar, the Flight School Connector, and our survey and awards, which will come up this fall. Turning it back over to you, Pablo.
All right. Now we got Stephen. Say hello, Stephen.
Hello, Stephen.
Introduce yourself and let's keep going.
Oh, I'm a coordinator for Flight Training Initiative, so I somehow try to keep these two guys coordinated and on task. Photographer, artist, runner, dad to a very precocious 12-year-old. She's keeping me very busy these days. So, working from the background, keep it rolling.
Very nice. Thank you, Stephen. And finally, our guest, a very important guest, special guest, if you will, Paul Feldmeier. That's the guy with the chroma cam on his face.
Paul, chroma cam.
Introduce yourself, Paul.
Well, I'm one of the senior techs over in the Pilot Information Center, CFI, IMEI, all that fun stuff. Used to work at Embry-Riddle, and I'm the point of contact for the PIC for a bunch of stuff. Been almost 9 years at AOPA. So,
fantastic. Awesome. Well, thank you. He's obviously a wealth of knowledge, and some of the questions they get, maybe we'll cover that later. There's some goodies.
Paul knows a lot.
And finally, I don't know if you'll notice, but this is not a background. This is actually, I wish we could see people back there. I am live on location, DuPage Airport Travel Express, my alumni. I've graduated from here to become famous pilot, you see here. And we have right here, William, who's a CFI here at Travel Express. Want to say a few words?
Hey, absolutely. Appreciate Pablo coming out, bringing the seminar. Don't get rusty. We appreciate you guys willing to come out here and share this with us, giving students the opportunity to talk to some instructors, to answer those questions that everybody has. So really appreciate AOPA and the time and the effort they put into putting together seminars like that. So we really appreciate it.
Cool.
Well, thank you, Paul.
How long have we known each other?
Wait, look at this. That's kind of cool. Thank you, William.
I appreciate it, Mark.
Thanks, buddy. If you're around, stick around and come by.
Thank you.
All right, guys. Let's get to the most basic of reminders, but yet the most important. And really, in this thing, because it's Q&A, this is the most important question asked. Yes, you get Wings credit. Yes, you get Wings credit. You have to be live to get Wings credit.
In other words, watching this live broadcast.
This, and it has to be with the email that you registered with. So if you registered with your Gmail and you sign in with your Hotmail, that's correct.
Yeah, for your FA Wings course, whatever you use for the Wings account,
that's right.
That email is what you had to submit it to us. Yes.
That's right. Lastly, you can see us at many places. So we're live here. We're hoping to get to many other live areas, Facebook, some other stuff too soon here. But for now, we're here. You can see this recording, which usually takes, I'm going to say 24 hours. Let's just call it that, 48 tops. But it'll be at many locations, including the AOPA live channel on YouTube. And just look for us in webinars. We should be right at the top since we're pretty good. Also, you can find us at webinars.aopa.org and also search for us there. Yep. All right. There
important note on the wings credit, there's nothing you need to do. You don't need to email me. You don't need to contact us. I will collect the names at the end, and they will be submitted automatically. So I got you.
Good note, my friend. Good note. All right, let's move on. So real quick, this is important because we want to point things out that are important to aviation. In this case, look up Jacqueline Cochran, probably somebody you've never heard of, but you should. Set a world record on this day, 1939, flying at 30,052 feet, 5 inches. Don't rob her of the 5 inches. Palm Springs, California, the spacecraft model 7. How did they know that? Okay, so look her up. It's important. Okay.
All right. Hey, it's a poll time.
It's poll time.
Steven, roll that poll. So the question is, and Paul is from AOPA's Pilot Information Center, how many people did AOPA's Pilot Information Center assist last year? So your choices are A, 5, B, 32,313, C, 64,907, or D, just helping one member is priceless. What do you guys think? Paul, I know that you may know the answer to this, but where would you probably answer this if you didn't already work there?
You actually want me to vote, even though it says organizers and panelists don't vote?
No, don't vote.
Just tell us, what would you pick here? Is it, I'm guessing for you, it's D, just helping that one member.
Yeah, it's the last one. Yeah. And these are only members we directly help. It's not the millions of TFR emails and everything else that the PIC generate aren't actually in this. So this is direct contacts with members. So it's definitely not D or A. And B is probably a little low.
Oh, you're giving it away now. Okay. All right. So where are we at here? We're at 75%. That's usually where we cut it off, huh? So
yeah, let's go ahead.
On for about
let's
a minute.
See the results.
Let's see the numbers.
And the numbers are, so we got a pretty even split there. But the 39%, they've got it. 64,907 as of last year. That was context. And like Paul said, that's not even counting all the emails and other information that we send out and webinars and everything.
And by the way, that 26%, they're right. For me, my personal side, it's just one person I can help. That's I'm happy. They understand. They understand our plight.
And so just to give a little preview of what's going on here today, too, the stuff we're covering, we're going to talk very briefly about the AOPA Pilot Information Center and just let them know that it's there, because a lot of folks may not be aware of this great resource. But what we did, of course, with this Ask a CFI, we put the question out to everybody and people were able to submit questions. And these are the topics. And so it was the gamut. And luckily, we've got Paul on here to help out because he knows a ton of stuff. And so he's going to help us out with air traffic control systems, operations, airspace, flight ops, flight training, flight reviews. I mean, you can see the whole list all right there, including even getting down to a really good one that Paul knew about that I did not know about, getting answers from the FAA. He's going to share that secret towards the end of the presentation today. So let's get moving.
Cool.
All right. So, Paul, do you want to tell us a little bit about just AOPA's Pilot Information Center? Just a quick overview of, I've got the list up here, the main topics, yeah. But how would you describe the center for members that may not be aware of it?
So it's a benefit that a lot of members, we've had 30-year members call and say we've never even called us. They don't even know we exist. So it is a member benefit, use us, but we've got a medical group, we've got digital product support, and then, of course, we've got the pilots that include mechanics as well. Answer anything under the sun. If we can't answer it, there's probably a good chance we can point you in the right direction. So it doesn't hurt to call us, and that's what we're actually here for. So
it's cool, and it's great. And I actually, my first very beginning at AOPA, I worked in the Pilot Information Center for about a year, and it's unbelievable the amount of information that is available through that group. So there's the contact info. I put this on every slide going forward, so in case you want to get hold of them, and plus on the handout, the same information is there if you want to download that. So right there, 1-800-USA-AOPA, open 8:30 to 6 Eastern, and there's the email, pilotassist@aopa.org. And I know, Paul, there's an online chat available, too. I think it's pretty typical.
Yeah, it'll pop up when it's available on the website. Depending on what topic you're looking at, it will direct you to the right group, or cool. Should.
All right. So let's get to the first questions here. So the first, I went through all the questions that were submitted, and unfortunately, it's like we had to cut it off. It was like on Monday we cut it off because there were so many questions. I'm sorry.
We just got some this morning too, by the way.
I know. I'm sorry, folks. It's like we had to be able to organize everything, and we'll try to hit up the other ones as they come in. But first, let's get going with this air traffic control. We had two. One was on flight following, and the person was asking, when you're on flight following, what's the difference on flight following between following an assigned heading versus being told to resume your own navigation? So, Paul, do you want to tell us what your thoughts are there, or what you think the answer is?
Well, I mean, an assigned heading is an instruction from ATC. You have to comply, or you need to be able to tell them that you're unable to comply. Own navigation, if you've got some weird, you want to go look at your house and then continue on, own navigation means they might question you why you're going the way you are, but you get to choose the way you go. So that's the main difference there.
Cool. And so on that own navigation, you can go the way, but they might ask, and I've had that happen too, where I'm taking like a more roundabout way and they might say, are you still going to this airport? And you just let them know, yes, I'm doing this, but I'm going to deviate over here or whatever. They just want to know so they can route IFR traffic around you.
Chris, I don't know if you mentioned it, but for those out there that maybe weren't here last month or something and didn't get to see this, these are all questions that were pre-asked. So we did send out a form for people to ask questions, and we got, like Chris said,
a lot.
So we're not going to have them all here, unfortunately. But and then there's a couple coming in here too. So we'll have a bunch of those to ask. But these are all we figured it'd be easier that way than just trying to sit there and read and answer and read and answer. So that's where we're going. Go ahead.
And we will try to keep the pace up here so that we can take the live ones at the end. All right. So the other part was, do you need to provide an explanation to ATC when you say, I'm unable to do something? Say, for example, they say, take that next left, or you need to turn that heading right now. It's like you might say there's a cloud right there and you're flying VFR, unable, right? Do you need to explain? So what do you think, Paul? Do we have to explain that?
If prompted by ATC, you might need to give an answer. Like, you're trying to turn me into a helicopter, or there's a cloud there, or something like that. But ultimately, PIC can say unable and do what you need to do to keep yourself safe, and then you can explain it afterwards.
Exactly. So that's the same idea of the aviate, navigate, communicate. So it's like if there's something imminent and you're saying, I'm just saying unable, I've got to take care of this, do it. And then I have a second, then I can call back and say, this is why I did that. But typically, though, if you're not, usually that's not the case, that it's that imminent, you can say unable to maintain VFR or unable to whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, great. Let's go to the next topic. Again, the Pilot Information Center contact is down below. This was an interesting one that came up. Somebody asked, and in fact, let me just look at the actual question here. It says, why is the magneto? And if you look there on where the ignition switch is, the left is to the right and the right is to the left on the switch. You may have noticed that before. And they said, why is that? Is there really a right and left magneto? Excuse me, Paul. I'll turn that over to you.
We're all stoked up about it.
Yeah, so it's just the way it's set up. There could be different, there's exceptions to every rule, but typically if you have the key on left, you're running the left mag and you've grounded the right one, and vice versa for the other one. So explanation of why it's set up that way, because that's the way Cessna wanted it, or that's the way Piper wanted it, but you just need to know for purposes of informing a mechanic, the key was on right and stumbled, or it never dropped, which means it never grounded the other mag. That's the kind of stuff you need to know.
Right, cool. So it's like you're ground, like in the case, it seems like you're grounding out the left one, which is saying the right one is on or something. It's just, it's weird, and it's just the way that it is. All right, this other question we had, and this is one, there is a link on the handout that Paul provided for this oxygen question. So on your handout, there's a couple times through the presentation where we've got a link for your reference, but this person was saying they were having a hard time finding documents or description of what was better to use when it comes to both pressurized, non-pressurized airplanes and Part 91 and so on. They know the altitude requirements, but what are the altitude limits for things like using a cannula versus a mask, or going over altitude changes, et cetera. And so, Paul, you found this great resource. You want to describe the thing that they're going to find in the handout?
Yeah, it's a brochure, a pilot safety brochure that the FAA put together, and it talks about, diluter demand, continuous flow, pressure demand systems, when they can be used, and that. You obviously also have a source through the manufacturer, and the manufacturer is probably oxygen systems are probably one of the only products. They're not going to boast and fib about the capability of their system because they don't want to get sued. So if they say you can use a cannula up to 18,000 feet, then you'd use a cannula up to 18,000 feet. After that, you need dilute or demand or what have you. But the pamphlet is really good and goes through that kind of stuff. And then obviously the manufacturer is going to be the expert because this isn't regulatory. So you need to follow what the manufacturer says. So
cool. Awesome. And that's a great find you had there. So check that out. Okay. Pablo?
Now, real quick, because we are pertinent here with some of these, there's someone that says, does 1 mag ground out when you go to start? Do we know this?
I would say that, I don't know, now we're going to be just, we'd have to get a mechanic on. I don't know if you know that. Do you know the answer definitively?
I definitively know. I mean, if you've got slick start system, there's all sorts of different systems. The best thing to do is talk to the mechanic that works on your plane.
Cool.
Or at your flight.
The base answer, I would guess, on a typical airplane, probably not, because you're going to want that full spark to get the thing fired up. So I'm going to guess probably not. But yeah, check that.
And then we did have a flight follow-in too. I just saw it right after we left. Is I thought during VFR flight following, assigned heading is optional. Are we still, as we are still VFR, is that correct?
Go ahead, Paul.
You're under ATC control. If you've got an obligation to follow ATC instructions. So you can go ahead and cancel flight following, and then you can do whatever you want. You can ask for whatever you want, but if ATC says, I need you to fly this heading, then you fly that heading.
So this is typically going to happen more like if you're like around Bravo airspace or someplace busy. It doesn't normally happen when you're on flight following out cruising, but if they say, I need you to turn this way, there's a reason, just like Paul said, and so you need to do it. And so, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, all right. And I've got some more, and just so you guys know, as you ask these, I'll just put them in Q&A. Thank you.
Cool. All right, airport ops. We had quite a number for the airport ops questions, and this is one that actually I was curious about myself. So, Paul, that one about what's the difference between Multicom, Unicom, CTAF, like the whole deal that the person was asking, and you found a great handout, the link you put in there. Mm-hmm. Do you want to just give us the basic rundown on what the difference is?
So it's an advisory circular that they put out. It's about 32 years old, but it still holds true. CTAF is exactly what it is, Common Traffic Advisory Frequency. That sometimes can be used as a UNICOM because everybody's listening to the CTAF. UNICOM is universal communication, and a multicom is it's basically for essential communications at an airport. Pretty much, it's most small airports that have these, they're shared. They're the same frequency. If you can't raise them on CTAF, then you have UNICOM to set up fuel or ask if the FBO is open or whatever it may be.
And I believe I remember reading that the Multicom, I think if I'm not mistaken, I think the Multicom might be for private airports. It said something like that too. It depended. So
yeah,
I thought I saw that in the handout. I may be wrong. But
you could have a Multicom if you have your own operation, you need to talk to your base and that kind of stuff. Yeah. So
anyway, check that handout out. Check out the handout. It's cool. And then, like I said, most of the time it's all the same frequency anyway. All right, that leads us right into locating airport info. The person was asking, when you're going to an unfamiliar airport, how do you know things like what are the current practices there, like the names identifiers of run-up pads, or how do you call ground to begin taxiing, or what are the known landmarks they might use for flying the pattern or for noise abatement? That sort of stuff's what they're asking. So what do you say, Paul? What are your recommendations here? I know we both got ideas here.
Well, you can always see if they have a website because they like to post that stuff there. You can also, unfamiliar airports, I'd like to go to Google Earth and look and use that to look around and see what's around. That's always helpful. You can always call the FBO as well and see if they have stuff. Obviously, as a transient aircraft, they're not going to expect you to know what the quarry is like here at Frederick or any of that other stuff, you know, the cement plant. You may know what those things are, but you don't know where they are. So become as familiar as you can, and usually they will have placards at the end of the runways if there's noise abatement and things like that.
Yeah, and the big thing I know is, of course, look at your chart supplement, and there's the information in there. AOPA's airport directory, we have the little kneeboard things. There's often notes in there about that. And like I said, I think the website and calling is probably some of the best to do because they'll have the handouts or things to tell you where these places are. Like Bay Bridge Airport's a good example of that here in Maryland. All right, the next question came down to, you're on, you're landing, you're doing your rollout on landing, and ATC says they want you to get off at taxiway Bravo. I'll just make one up. Get off at taxiway Bravo. But as you're rolling, you're kind of going too quick and you miss it. You're not able to stop in time. You know, what do you do then? So says a landing, it says you exit this thing, you pass it, and you're, it's like, what do you do? Do you tell them right then while you're rolling out? Do you just get off at the next taxiway? They kind of wanted to know what to do. And I know you provided a link for this one too, Paul, in the AIM, but tell us what the answer was here. What should we do?
So you're expected to clear without delay on the next available taxiway. You got to be careful that you don't do it on the next available runway, because that is a runway incursion, because you just went onto a runway that you weren't cleared onto. So, but you're expected to go to the next taxiway and get clear of the runway. If you can't make it, you can't make it. And if it's a quarter mile down the runway, ATC would probably like you to expedite. But it's one of those things where you can stay unable. You know, if you're still doing 50 knots across the ground, you're not going to be able, unless it's a high speed, you're not going to be able to make it. So unable, but you're expected to clear at the next taxiway.
Right.
Unless otherwise instructed.
And don't, in fact, it says in the AIM, do not try to turn around and go back to the taxi where you were sent. That is not okay. It specifically states that in the AIM. The other thing, too, that I know that both Paul and I have experienced as CFIs is that, you know, you're slowing down and you might have, I've had it happen with students where they then try to turn to that taxiway and remember that you are in typically a tricycle. Tricycles don't do well with turns at high speed. I've had one where the wheel came off the ground and I had to push on the, slam on the rudder to get it back. So really be careful. Don't try to push the airplane past its limits. Slow down first. If you miss it, you miss it. Like you said, somebody may have to go around. It's not the end of the world. It's better than you causing an accident on the runway. Now this next one comes from someone. They had a really long explanation. It was a real thing that happened to them. They said it was not a hypothetical, but they were at an airport. I did verify it was a towered airport. They had parallel runways. The other pattern was full. They were in a busy pattern and were cleared to land. And as they're coming around, I guess they're base to final or on final. There was a helicopter also doing operations. And as they guess they're on final, they're cleared to land on that runway. But the helicopter's hovering over, I want to say it was like the 1,000-foot markers or something, on the runway they were cleared to land on. And they weren't sure what to do. They said, if I go around, I can't go into the other pattern, so I can't go to the right. The helicopter climbs and it had been operating to the left. So they weren't sure what to do. Do they go straight ahead and climb? Do they go to the left? So I know we talked about this one, Paul, so go ahead and give me your thoughts on that. Discuss.
Oh, it's the whole point of teaching aeronautical decision making. So if somebody's on the runway, you don't think it's safe, it's your job to inform ATC what you're doing. Because if the controllers aren't handling the helicopter, you just tell them, I'm going around, I'm going to climb up the pattern altitude, please tell the helicopter to stay where he is. And then they can figure things out, because obviously we're not a helicopter. If we're fixed wing, we can't hover. We can't stop. We're going to keep going forward. So just call the go around. It's always your decision. Get to where it's safe and then figure it out. But having an attitude where you're going to go down to the runway and hope the helicopter, no, that's not a good position, because your altitude gives you options. But being
we talked close, about, I think it was last, maybe two months ago, something like that. Remember, Chris? We had one, and there were so many if-then scenarios, and essentially at the end, we rounded up all saying, look, man, if you're the pilot in command,
right?
It's your decision. They might be telling you what to do with ATC, but you can tell them no, or like we said earlier, unable, or I need to do something because helicopter's just chilling. You're the PIC, man. Keep control. Mm-hmm. It's not safe. It's not safe, regardless of the reason. Just let them know.
I want to just reiterate what Paul said too, is do it early. Think early. If you see a situation like, I don't like this, don't even go down there. Just say, I'm going to stay up high. I'll just make a pass above and come back around. Because the last thing you want to do is down low to the ground.
So. And by the way, even more importantly, I would say in a non-towered airport. Because at this point, you don't know what people are doing, because they might not even be on the radio. That's happened to me, where you're like, I don't hear them, but here they come.
Well, like, hopefully no one said anything. They're not running parallel runway opposing pattern operations in an uncontrolled field. That would be...
I went to a field in St. Louis at night. It was about midnight. And so the tower was not working at that time anymore. And I was coming in an easterly runway. And there was a jet on the westerly runway. So I could see their lights as I'm coming in. And I made every call. And I didn't hear one from this guy. So it was like, what do? You land anyway? Yeah, sure. Why not? No, it's like, it was clearly a jet, right? So I had to go around, but it was like, you know, it's one of those situations. Like, why would you even be on the radio? I don't understand that. Anyway, all right, let's keep it moving.
And you're right, Paul. Hopefully it's a tower, but I just, as you were saying that, I remember I used to fly at Deer Valley Airport, had parallel runways, and at night the tower would close. So we had parallel runways at night, and it was uncontrolled, and we did have helicopters there. So it usually just wasn't busy. All right, the last question. We had a lot on this slide, and I want to keep it moving.
That's a good one.
Got to keep it up. That is a good question. For the X mile left base, plug in your number here, whether it's 2, 3, whatever. When you're told by ATC, make a 3 mile left base or a 2 mile left base. We had this question come up. We've talked about this one, I know, twice before on the program. But the big thing here is check out this diagram. We got this directly from an ATC expert. And the deal was, he said that when they say make a 3 mile left base, they want the base to be a half mile out the way that it normally would be. So they don't want you flying 3 miles out and making like a huge 3 mile final, base to final. They want you to make your base 3 miles from the airport, but still a half mile from the runway, if this makes sense. So in other words, you're 3 miles extended base, and then when you turn your final, you'll make that 90 degree turn and be on a half mile final. I hope that makes sense, but that's the clarification for that one. Cool. Any other questions or any other thoughts here, Paul, or anything?
Nope.
All right, let's go. Let's move to the next one. This is just one question on this slide, so this is good. This was an interesting one that, and I had to go find an example, like you said, Paul, up in Alaska for this one. Somebody was asking, they said that they'd seen something like this where it showed Class Echo going to 14.5 or whatever, but they don't see that on the chart anywhere. Like, why is it even mentioned? And so we wanted to differentiate between the magenta shaded line you'd see here for Echo and this blue shaded line. So Paul, do you want to go ahead and take this one?
Yeah, it used to be everywhere, and we've actually got some calls from instructors that go, where did it all go? Well, it all went to Alaska. The coverage has gotten better. They've dropped the floor of Echo in most places down to 1200 feet or 700 feet or the surface. You very rarely will see it outside of Alaska, basically because Echo is considered controlled because that's where IFR traffic is, and they've dropped, the coverage is so good now that they've done away with a lot of the 14.5 stuff. So when you look at the cloud clearance requirements that you're required to know, most of us will never see the 1200 class Echo above 1200 unless you go to Alaska, but you still got to know the cloud clearances. So it's just one of those things that's going to be going away as technology gets better.
And that's what I figured too. My thought was exactly that, was just as GPS came into prevalence too, and people are going more direct and they got better radar, they just dropped the Echo down so they could do all the IFR ops. So that is there. So you can go up in Alaska, you can see this airport here. It's PA or Papa Alpha Foxtrot Sierra, or I guess it's Foxtrot Sierra Papa. There's two, of course, Alaska does that with two different codes. You can check it out and see that. Otherwise, in the continental US, you're not going to see this much. All right, let's go ahead and jump to flight ops.
Oh, we had four questions. Here we go again. Flight following.
Yes. So this question was basically calling for flight service, and they were asking, the situation was, and they actually gave us a one right here at home. They said, you know, I'm not sure if this person was from here in our region or just knew about it, but they said, you're at Frederick, and you're near Winchester Regional, which is not far from here. And in your EFB, it says, you know, the nearest ATC is 133.55 Washington, et cetera, but they said, you know, and you see flight service, but they don't know when you call, normally you would say the name of the radio, like Leesburg radio or whatever, but if it doesn't specify which one it is, how do you know what to say when you're calling flight service on, and typically on 122.2? And so in this case, my recommendation here would just be, I just say, I don't know about you, Paul, but I just say flight service, because if you're not sure what it is, and they will come back and say, aircraft calling, this is Leesburg radio. You guys have other thoughts on that?
Just make sure you're telling them, it's not as prevalent now, but just make sure you tell them what you're transmitting, receiving on, especially if you're receiving over the VOR, because if you don't tell them, they've got several radios all tied into them, and they, if you don't say I'm transmitting on 121.5 and receiving on 122, whatever, 117, whatever the VOR is, they don't know how to communicate. So then they got to go through each one in the line to try to get a hold of you.
Right.
It takes a long time. Yeah.
Good. That's a good point. Hey, I know we discussed this one too. This next question had to do with if you're on.
Oh, let me get this one. Let me get this one.
Okay.
The flight following one. I love flight following.
Okay. So do you want to answer this one, Pablo, or do you know the question?
No, I want to ask it.
Okay, go. Do it.
Yeah. Okay, so someone asked about heading into restricted airspace while on flight following. And will they be notified? So can they just keep flying into this restricted airspace? Not CFRAs or anything. They're just saying in general. Yeah. Do they need to take other actions?
Go ahead, Paul.
Okay.
You're the man here.
It's important to know who the controlling agency is and ask them. Calling flight service probably isn't going to be the controlling agency. Chances are, if you're on flight following, you're talking to the controlling agency of that restricted area. And just like anything else, if you don't know, ask. It doesn't hurt anything to ask. It does to fly into a restricted area, and then you get a 30-day vacation from flying from the FAA. So if you're not sure, if you don't know if it's cold or it's hot, ask. That's all you need to do.
Great advice.
And for those students out there, cold or hot just means active or not active.
Correct.
All right. We get a lot of students here, Paul. So a lot of times when we use acronyms and stuff, they're like, what does that mean?
Well, it's one of those things you got to, as an instructor, you got to keep remembering that you're not, there's too many acronyms. There's too many things we use in aviation. So
absolutely.
Sometimes we create acronyms just to organize acronyms. All right. So the next one is, this person was asking about ADS-B and it was about flying across the mountain. So I guess this person did not have or does not have ADS-B installed in their aircraft. And you may know that typically, depending on your area, you have to check, like if you're near Bravo, there's different rules. But generally across most of the U.S., if you're below 2,500 feet, you don't have to have ADS-B. But they were asking, how do I go across the mountains then? How do I get across Colorado and places like that, across the Rockies or whatever? Do you have to stay within the bubble of 2,500 feet without ADS-B? And Paul, the answer is?
You got to follow the rules. 91.225 is the reg. It closely mirrors mode C transponder, which is 91.215. So you do have to follow the rules. Now, if you're going to be doing a one-time trip where you're ferrying an airplane that doesn't have an electrical system or whatever, you got to look at the reg. But a lot of the times you can use what's called the ADAPT program, which is a deviation tool. It's almost like filing a flight plan. You're letting FAA know you can't comply, and you can get permission to fly in ADS-B required airspace without having ADS-B. It's not meant to be a stopgap for life, but if you have a one-time operation where you need to do it, like crossing the Rockies or something like that, you absolutely can. But you got to use the systems in place, and if all else fails, and this is going to be something you're going to be doing all the time, you're gonna have to equip. That's just if you want your life to be easier.
There it is. I think it's pretty simple. So you do.
Is there a limit to that ADAPT system?
Like, can you use it once, twice? A couple 135 operators figured out there's a limit, and they shut off access to them. It's meant to be a thing to get you in and out, to get equipped, or to get you through airspace if you're ferrying a plane. It's not meant to be 10 times a day because you don't want to equip your King Air or something like that. And so it is meant to be a stopgap, and if you make yourself a nuisance, they will turn off your access.
So now I ask because I know that someone was thinking that out there. Yeah, the almost 600 people out there, someone was thinking it.
So, all right, we're going to try to keep this moving because we've got so many more questions. We'll try to roll. This one, I'll take this one and just keep it brief. The best power settings for phases of flight. Someone was asking about, for an example, a 172. What are the best power settings to use for climb, et cetera, et cetera? And I think the recommendation, I know Paul and I discussed this as well, is basically just follow your POH. If it's the manufacturer says it's okay, you can do that. You may know some people that are really experienced at flying whatever type of model airplane it is, maybe a Cessna pilots group, and you can ask their advice too, but just I would stay within the manufacturer's recommendations, but then you'll figure out what it is you like to do, and you can ask other experienced people. So there's not a definitive answer for this one way or the other. So all right, let's go ahead and we'll jump to flight training and learning. There's two slides on flight training. We had a lot of questions about this. The first one was asking, they were just having a hard time finding a good quality CFI. They said, a lot of times you get things where you're working with the CFI and then they get enough time and then they move on to their next stage in their flight training, whether it's going to the airlines or something like that. how do you recommend, like the person was asking, what do we do to make sure we've got a decent CFI through our training? They said, do we do something like always have two CFIs, or what's the thing to do, and where do we find the ones that want to teach, and how do we promote them? So Paul, do you want to give us your thoughts on that?
Well, you guys do that flight training awards thing every year. So that's one way, even though AOPA doesn't recommend flight instructors. The other thing is more experienced CFIs, there are guys that hang out at FBOs. They have no drive to go to the airlines. They like instructing. Doesn't mean they're any better or worse than anybody else, but it's one of those things where you're the customer, and if you think you're being sold up the river and you don't you know, mesh with your CFI, go fly with somebody else. You're the customer. If you don't like the school, find a new school. A lot of students feel like because they're a student or a customer, they're locked into whoever's assigned to them, and that's not the case. And you could have the best CFI in the world, but if your personality doesn't mesh with theirs, you're not going to learn anything. It's one of those things. You got to remember you're a customer. Don't abuse it, obviously, and don't, you know, force the CFI to spoon feed you because you're the customer. But you got to remember, it's a lot of money. If you don't like your CFI, you guys aren't seeing eye to eye, or you don't like the way they teach, go get another one. Try them all out. See which one you mesh with the best and fly with them.
That's good advice. And like you said, too, we have the Flight Training Experience Survey and Awards opens up this fall through AOPA. Of course, they got to talk about it because I run it. Steven and I run it together. And so with that, check it out. And we do try to recognize those great CFIs. All right, we got to keep, I know we're trying to keep it moving. It's like, yep, this is crazy, all these questions. So learning new tech in avionics. Somebody was asking about, they're a rusty pilot. They learned on steam gauges. They flew on steam gauges, and now they're trying to get back into it. And they see all the GPS and everything else. And they're not trying to say that, like, I just don't want this new stuff, but they're just trying to figure out what's the best way to go about learning it without having to spend, you know, $200 an hour for an airplane, another 70 for an instructor. And so I know one of my pieces of advice is there's, different courses or software you can get that simulate that. That's a good way to do it. Paul, do you want to give another tip there?
There's books, there's YouTube videos, there's all sorts of stuff. Probably the best thing to learn is hands-on. So ask your school, do they charge for ground GPU time? Plug the airplane in and just do all the scenarios you want in the GPS, in the G1000, whatever it ends up being. It's a lot less costly than running the engine at the same time.
There you go. And you might even, some schools may even have a simulator where they've got that piece of avionics in it as well. That is, whether it may not be exactly close enough to get you your basics, to get down the basic functions. So check that out. This question I loved, which was, it's from a student pilot asking what to study for the check ride oral. They said, there is so much. How do I narrow it down? Paul, I see you smiling. Go for it.
So there's lots of study guides. There's even YouTube videos that something, yes, I didn't have. There's YouTube videos of check rides. Every, yep, DPE, every training center evaluator, they have their own pet peeves. They have the things that they go after. And truthfully, a lot of instructors have crib notes on those DPEs, and they know what they hammer on and what they don't. We used to have an observer program at Embry-Riddle. You could go and observe a check ride. And the ground or the oral portion was probably the best thing to observe because the flights are just flights. It's the same stuff every time. But just try to learn as much as you can. Watch the videos, the oral exam guides, all that stuff. You're never going to know everything. I don't know everything. There's always something to learn. But you do need to know the basics, and you got to make sure that the emergency action items and the things you have to know right now have to be at the top of your head. If you know where to find the information, and it's something like how many fuses do I have to carry? Well, that's a pre-flight item. So as long as you need to know, you know where to find that information, it's not really something you have to have memorized, especially if that's the only thing you don't have memorized. So remember your resources, and the immediate action items are the things that you need to know off the top of your head. Everything else is cursory.
Exactly. And so, and there's a little, like I said, I want to just reiterate, those little study prep guides are great. And then just know your stuff well enough, have done the reading ahead of time so you know where things are. For example, if you wanted to find it in Rod Machado's Private Pilot Handbook, you can find it there. I'm teasing. But so yeah, just find, know your materials. If you know your materials, if you have a good textbook, whatever it is that you go, you'll be able to look it up. And I tell my students the exact same thing. If you know most of it, they're going to let you look stuff up. It's one thing if you have to look up everything, that's not good. But if it's just a few things, it's okay. All right. Yeah. Can you, Paul, we'll keep this one kind of brief. Instrument training during private. Does instrument training that you do during private count for instrument training for your instrument rating?
Maybe. If you've got a double eye that's giving you the training, then it could count. If you have just a straight CFI that's not a double eye, the whole thing is that the training that you get in your private is not necessarily instrument training. If it's just the regular CFI that's giving you the training that's not an instrument instructor, then it is not instrument training. If it is a double eye giving you that training, you could use it towards your instrument because it's actually training from an instrument instructor. So that's kind of the long, short version.
Cool. And I think that's the basic answer right there. So it just depends on who's giving it to you. This person asked about learning to use a VOR, and basically it sounds like they're having a hard time with the VOR questions on the private pilot written. Steven, I know, just did his written shortly too, and he can probably attest to the fact that the questions that are on the FAA test about VORs are not like the way that we do it in real life at all. So in that case, you learn enough to get those questions done. But then my recommendation here is to take learn the VORs. The sims are great. I know, Paul, you talked about going out to the parking lot and drawing the compass rose and like walking around it and with your CFI. But take the time to learn it. It is really valuable. It's a great backup. It is the backup for GPS. And if you don't know how to use it, therefore it's not a backup. So it is worth learning, but don't get caught up on those written test questions because they're kind of wonky the way that they're asked. Yeah, I hear you. But they're kind of wonky the way they're asked. So don't get too caught up on that. How about trim during steep turns, Paul? What do you think? This person was on a check ride, I guess it sounds like. The DPE said, hey, you're working too hard, showed them how to trim it. And they said, should I be doing that or should I not be? And I know we've got some different opinions here.
It's a personal preference. Some people like to muscle through it. You got to realize that if you're really muscling that aircraft through there, all your fine motor skills go away because you're using so much muscle. So trim is, use it as trim. Now, if you're showing off, I mean, two strips of trim and a 172 will give you a perfect 50 degree steep turn without you having to put any input in. But it's one of those things where use the trim if you feel like you need to. Don't if you don't want to, and listen to your instructor. If your instructor says you need to use some trim because you're not holding that nose up or you're muscling the airplane so much you can't actually finally control your bank, then that's something you need to pay attention to. But I would never teach somebody that they have to use trim or they can't use trim because it's a control surface. You use it as you need it.
And it could very well be that maybe this DPE was trying to show that maybe they saw the student not. And I know that I didn't learn how to use trim very well until after my private. And so it was something maybe they were just trying to show them like, hey, use trim. And that at that point, it's a good idea. But I will say that I am a big fan of Rob Machado's. And he specifically wrote an article about this, said you should not trim it. Or like I think Paul's idea is if you need a little bit of trim, that's great. But he says because the point of the maneuver is trying to learn the control and the feels of the airplane sort of more on the edges like we would in slow flight and in steep turns. And he said if you trim it, then it takes all that away and you're not learning the feel of the airplane. So that was just his take on it. All right. Getting back to private
pilots.
Yes. Getting back to private pilot training after a long break. So this one was, we have two questions that were in the same category here. One was student pilot, they got 85% of the way to their training and then they had to stop. Kids, you know, they had kids, all their stuff got in the way. And so now they want to get back to it. They don't know where to begin. Had another person who was 52 years old. They got their private pilot a year ago. And then they aren't able to fly, so they're trying to keep proficient. So in other words, how do we stay proficient? What can we do to getting going again in this training? So what do you think, Paul?
Getting back into training after several years, just remember that your flight training, the hours you accrued count. You can use those. But the fact is you probably don't remember much. Now, a lot of it's like riding a bicycle, but you got to realize that you're a very experienced, really rusty pilot. And the flying might come back to you, but the knowledge stuff you need to brush up on. And just remember that you might end up starting from square one, and there's nothing wrong with that. You should pick it up quicker than other people that are just starting fresh. But it's don't let your pride get in your way. If you don't understand something, you don't know how to do it, make sure your instructor, because your instructor might be giving you too much of a benefit of the doubt. So that's my thing. And then staying proficient on the cheap, flying clubs, local EEA chapters, hey, do you need a safety pilot? That kind of stuff. You can get it a little bit cheaper. Flying clubs, most of the point of a flying club is either getting you a nice airplane that you can't rent or getting you a rental aircraft at a much cheaper price. So it all depends. Some of them you pay up front, some of them you pay as you go. But look at all your options. Don't think that you have to go to the local flight school to start flying and get back in.
Fly with friends that are training. You can sit in the back as long as they're not doing steep turns or stalls.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, we had the opportunity I mentioned before here in my school, where the owner would make flights and would invite us up if we were students. And so, you know, we would get right seat time in the Pilatus, you know, something like that. So, granted, you're not doing steep turns and stuff, but you're hearing the radio calls and you're still got stick time. So it's just all time in the airplane. It all matters.
Cool. And then the other thing I was going to say is don't discount simulators too. You can use a simulator to help you stay proficient as well. Treat it like you're in the airplane. Don't treat it like you're in a video game. Go through your procedures, run your checklist, because that's the stuff that goes away, is the mechanical part of flying the airplane. Like, a lot of that's still in you, but it's the stuff, the procedures, that's the stuff that disappears quickly. So just treat the sim like it's an airplane. That's another good way.
We had a door a question on this one. So sorry, Chris. Someone asked, can you just do a quick overview of what a safety pilot is and what they are required to have to be one?
So a safety pilot is essentially a very informed passenger until the other person puts the foggles on. And then at that point, there's two options for being a safety pilot. The one that's the most common is you are acting PIC, which means anything that happens on that plane, you're responsible for. It also means that you need to have a current flight review. You need to be rated in that airplane. You need to have a medical. You have to be able to essentially fly that airplane by yourself. If you can't do that, pretty much can't be safety pilot. There are some exceptions to the rules when it comes to the like tailwheel or high performance and things like that. Unless you really know what you're doing or you've called the PIC and asked your question, I'd stay away from that because there's also insurance implications and things like that. But as far as safety pilot goes, if you could fly that plane by yourself, you could be the safety pilot. And then you log PIC time for the time that you're a required crew member.
I was just going to say, again, that's just typically when somebody else is practicing instrument work under the hood.
Correct.
That's why you use
correct.
It.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. And for those watching, a foggle is something you'll use during your instrument portion of the private pilot, which is just basically a foggy goggle, so you can't see over the panel.
And sometimes called a hood or other things like that. Little
or
names
view, view limiting device, I think is what the FAA calls it.
Ooh, very
no CMs, I like to call them, no CMs. All right, so the other one is this person, and again, we've got so many more slides. We're just trying to keep this pace up because we're running out of time.
Come on, Chris.
I want to try it. I know I'm trying. Teaching declare an emergency, this person said, why doesn't training include teaching the phrase or teaching someone how to declare an emergency so they know about it early? And I completely agree. It's like we run emergency procedures, but absolutely we should be teaching to people to declare the emergency. So if you're a student pilot out there and your CFI is not doing that with them, ask them about it. How do I go about declaring an emergency? When should I do it? Don't be afraid of it. Don't worry about the paperwork, because I've done stuff like this. I've never had paperwork. So you need to do what you need to do to keep the airplane safe. Who cares about paperwork? It doesn't matter. If it's a real emergency, get it on the ground safely, get the help you need. Mm-hmm. All right. Flight reviews. First question.
That's a good one. Let me ask it.
Okay, go for it.
All right, this is a two-parter, actually. So what are the three most common reasons a BFR has failed? So there's actually so many things in that one. Oh, can I start? All right, it's not a BFR anymore. It's just an FR. And secondly, you can't fail one. Paul, take over.
So you can't fail a flight review. That's correct. It turns into a training flight the second it's not a good outcome, which isn't a bad thing. And the flight reviews are so vague on what they include.
Yeah.
It's basically those items that the instructor feels are necessary to complete. So typically it'll be landings for people that just do a flight review every 2 years and they don't fly very much. Landings, steep turns, and procedural type stuff. They know how to fly, but they just aren't up to PTS or ACS. But top failure items, there is no such thing. I mean, it really comes down to whatever the CFI wants to hammer you on, and especially if the CFI requires you to do a cross-country for your flight review. There's a lot of pilots out there that the last time they did a cross country, actually planned it out, was their check ride. So.
Exactly. And I would say just quickly, actually, this incorporates both questions into it. You're already kind of, and this, what you've already talked about does incorporate the two questions, because the other person was asking, they were in a flight review, they had a CFI, the radio comms weren't great, which, by the way, I agree, there's not really, you can't fail it. There's no failing this, but some of the things people normally have trouble with, emergency procedures, I see it being rusty, landings maybe not being as proficient as they might want to be, and then radio comms. That's a common thing too. People don't do stalls and things either. They of course they're normally afraid of them, or it makes them nervous, and that's totally okay. Go up with a CFI and practice that stuff. But the thing I would say here is talk to your CFI before you start the thing, because it's like the CFI, a good CFI is going to lay the whole thing out ahead of time and say, this is what we're going to do, this is what I want to see. And in fact, the other part they should be doing too is saying, what kind of flying do you plan on doing? And then we build the flight review around that. Oh, you want to be going on cross countries? Well, let's review some of that stuff. Oh, you want to be working on instrument? Let's review that. So we will develop it around you. And plus there'll be some things that we're going to want to see. I'm going to probably, like you, Paul, I want to see emergency procedures, landings. Those are my main things. And then the other stuff, it's I'm willing to build around what it is you want to practice.
Yep.
Hey, real quick, two safety pilot, just go back to it. I've got a couple of questions already. That's why I'm bringing it up now. Can you be a safety pilot with basic med?
Yes. Yes. Done.
That's why I asked it. Let's go.
That was a double yes. Absolutely. All right.
Triple yes. I'd already answered yes.
Oh, by the way, I guess the one caveat with that is if you are using basic med, you must be designated as PIC while you are the safety pilot, because if you are not, it's this weird FAA reg thing. If you're not designated as the PIC, then you can't be the safety pilot under basic med. So just make sure that the person says, I'm going under the hood, you are now the PIC, and then it's all hunky-dory.
99.9% of safety pilot operations, the safety pilot is PIC. When this basic med stuff came out, it exposed a weak area in knowledge of a lot of pilots out there. And they were worried that they can no longer be a safety pilot. If you were logging PIC time as a safety pilot in years past, you were doing it exactly the way that it's covered under basic med, and don't worry about it. Anything else, if you're worried about it, give us a call. We'll talk about it.
Okay, we've got...
Give you a call. Chris, give Paul's number.
No, yeah. No. It's like, give us a call.
USA AOPA, right there on the screen.
There's okay. Not many of them, but I'm not the only one.
Hey, we've actually already covered the staying proficient on a budget. The person, when we had somebody ask about IFR as well, and the biggest thing there is, it's again, I'd say using a simulator is one of the best ways to do it on a budget. And it's an idea of staying proficient. But let's go ahead and jump to the second part here, which is getting back into flying. This is going to be relatively easy. Getting back into flying, if you're like have been out for a while, and we had one person just say that they've been out, they're 52 years old, they're getting back into it. Another person is an airline pilot that wants to get back into GA. Well, believe it or not, AOPA's got some programs for you. We've got our Rusty Pilots program. So if you've been out for a while, and I was actually Rusty myself, I went through the same process, but we've got a Rusty Pilots program. Check it out at rustypilots.org. And then if you're an airline pilot that is trying to get back into GA, there's a program called Back to Your Roots. I worked on this. It was a few years back, but we're bringing it back this year. There's going to be some webinars later this year. If you'd like to get put on the mailing list for that, to know when those webinars will come, just email them at backtoyourroots@aopa.org. You'll see it right there on the screen, backtoyourroots@aopa.org, and check that out. So keep an eye out for that coming up later this year. Okay. IFR ops. I'm so excited we got to this one, because this is one we've had to skip before just for time. I wanted to make sure we hit it. I think we will be really close to getting all this done. So the first question, this is for someone who's a CFII. So we're lucky because both Paul and I are CFII. So hopefully we're going to be expert enough. I know Paul is. We'll see if I am. This they said that the IFR currency states that the tasks and maneuvers include to stay current are 6 instrument approaches, holding procedures and tasks, and intercepting and tracking. They were doing an IPC with an instructor, and the instructor had said that, oh no, you don't have to do holding and intercepting, you can just do holding or intercepting. What do you think, Paul? Does that, which one's right?
So I think it's kind of a moot point. Do a hold, and tracking and intercepting will take care of itself while you're doing the approaches. Whenever you are talking regs, the best thing to do is actually to pull up the reg itself and look at it. I don't believe it says or. I'm going to pull it up right now. 6157.
Yeah, I did check. It does not say or. It's on. It just says list them all, and there's no or.
So, and always look up the reg. It does, if it doesn't have an or, you're expected to do everything on the list. So
yep.
Do a hold, do your approaches. Intercepting and tracking will take care of itself because you can't do an approach without doing those. So, exactly. Yes, everything is required.
And just log it like that. That's what I do. I absolutely agree. Don't do intercepting and tracking and then not do a hold because now you haven't done the hold part. But if you do the hold and the approaches, you've done everything else. But just log all of it because as part of doing those, you literally say, I intercepted and tracked, did holds, et cetera, and you've got it all covered.
And real quick, too, you're going to need a hat to do these IFR operations. Am I right?
I think you might.
Yeah. So I think if any of the first three people that write will get a hat and or a toque, as we would say in Canada.
Up there in Quebec.
That's right. So the first three, remember, so don't hit me 10 minutes from now because we'll have 30 by then.
There it
is. All right. Thank you.
Put
continue.
In your request.
That's okay. Right.
Here's this one, Paul. I don't know that we really know the answer to this, but the question was, why is it that holds, the standard hold direction is right turns and the standard traffic pattern is left turns? What do you think, Paul? Do we have an answer for this? Do you know this?
I think it's an opinion thing. The left hand, I've heard for the traffic patterns makes sense. Most fixed wing guys sit on the left as PIC. They need to be able to see over or under the wing while they're doing their turns. That all makes sense. I've never heard a good argument other than opinion about why they differ. I've never heard one. I've never seen a reference that directly calls it out other than I heard one time or his inspector told me one time. So I don't know what the reasoning is there.
So, and that's fair. And in fact, we do have a slide at the very end, how to get hold of the FAA, and you can throw that question at them and see if they'll maybe give you a stated answer. I kind of doubt that they'll be able to, but
yeah,
I think it's just the way that it is. And we maybe digging back into the old, the Federal Register, when they put those regs in, maybe there's some explanation in that old stuff.
Maybe, but at the end of the day, it's one of those questions of, if you're not trying to win a beer from one of your buddies, knowing the answer, there really isn't any purpose other than knowing what they are and executing them correctly.
Exactly. A beard? You can win a beard?
Yeah.
Awesome. No. A beer or a Coke. I don't know what you call it in Canada.
That's a Molson. All right. So, or Labatt's. So then we've got the proper title. If this person was doing some practice approaches and they wanted to do an RNAV GPS approach, they're using the GPS. They want to know what's the right title to use when requesting this approach. I know for me, I would just call it an RNAV because that's the main title. What do you think, Paul? Does it matter?
It doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter. As long as ATC knows what you're doing and they can expect what you're doing, it doesn't matter what you call it.
Fair enough. And then the other one was, we had somebody saying they were doing a GPS approach, and on GPS approaches, or if you're really old school and you've got a DME approach, rather than having a 1 minute hold distance, this one had a distance stated, 4 nautical miles or whatever. And they were asking, during the hold entry, do you have to go the full 4 nautical miles during the hold entry, or can you go less than that? Go ahead,
and
Paul.
Basically, that's your protected area. You can go less than that. The AIM spells it out, but it's you're not doing the hold. You're doing the entry at that point. And one thing is for absolute sure, you can't go outside of it. So that kind of answers the question there. You cannot go outside of that. You can't exceed that distance. So.
And I believe, I think I put the link to this on the handout as well, where it was, you could read about that with the whole distance, and I specified which one it was. So you can check that out and see that in the AIM. And then the last one for the IFR questions that we had here, if you have a CFII, an instrument instructor, who is not current for instrument flying, can they endorse you for an IPC? Paul?
Yes, you can actually, the same holds true for a flight review even. You cannot be current on your flight review. You cannot be current in instruments. The student would need to be for the flight review. And as far as the instrument, as long as you stay VFR, you're going to be fine.
Cool.
So it really doesn't make all that much sense, but it's legal.
It is. It's just it's the same rule too. Like if we're not landing current as CFIs, can we take someone up as a student and fly with them? And there's a letter of interpretation that says yes, we can, because yep. students are not passengers, so they don't count. So yeah, weird.
Cool. So 1 minute left, Chris.
I know. We've got two slides left, and then the FAA one, and then we'll go to questions. This is the official end, so if you're here looking for wings credit, it's okay if you need to drop off. We do have next month's topic, which we'll get to at the end here. But next month's topic is
Scroll up to it. See it.
Yeah, let me just scroll through that slide. We'll come back to this.
Yeah.
Now you see me, now you don't. The bad magic of VFR and IMC. We're actually introducing the Air Safety Institute. We're going to have a special guest on from our Air Safety Institute is going to be talking about their big campaign this year of working on VFR and IMC and how to avoid it. So we're going to talk about practical tips of how to avoid it or what you do to get out of it.
Sounds fun, Chris. It'll be fun to be there for that one.
Yes, it will. It'll be a good one. All right. And then we'll do the pilot passport here in just a second. Let's get back and
see. Can you go real quick, too, because it is time. I just want to make sure I get the people that wanted more info, the back to your roots, please. Go back to that one so they can see. They're going to take a picture of that slide because we got, there it is. So you've got 5 seconds. Stephen Hardy.
Back to
your roots. 1,000, 2, 1,000, 3, 1. Okay, good. Hope you got it.
Back to your roots at AOPA.org.
At AOP.org. Okay.
There you go.
And then lastly, since we are at time again, Brian, stocking hat. Way to go, Brian Dupree. Renee Shales got a hat, and Rick Lewis got a hat too. So nice. Congratulations. Stephen will get the info for you three, and we'll get those out to you in the mail.
Awesome.
Proceed.
Nice to have a little swag. All right, international flight ops here. So these were two that Paul knew about because it's like I knew some of the stuff back when I was working in the PIC, but I have not used that information. So Paul, tell us about if you're going to do an international flight and you have to file, the person was asking like, I don't understand. There's no box to check for filing a defense VFR flight plan when you go to do it. And the same thing is it says you have to provide a penetration time and point for the ATIS. They were asking, do you have to provide that? Or does ATC just know as you're approaching? Does four flight do that? How does that happen? So Paul,
real quick to start with what ADIZ is.
Oh, the Air Defense Identification Zone. It's crossing the U.S. border.
Well, crossing between Mexico and Mexico and the U.S. and crossing between Alaska and Canada. But the lower 48 in Canada, there is no ATIS.
Oh, okay.
So
isn't there one over the ocean, though?
Yeah, there is one if you're going overseas or across the ocean. But as far as between countries, there isn't one between the lower 48 and Canada.
Oh, cool.
So
friends to the north.
Yep. Mighty 51st state, right? so when you cross, you don't need to do a defense flight plan if you're IFR. So that just leaves VFR. And if there is no defense ICAO VFR flight plan, you just file a VFR flight plan and then you put your ATIS penetration and all the information that you need. You actually put that in line 18, which is kind of the remarks section. If you're in doubt and you don't do this all the time, just call a briefer, file it with them, let them know they'll make sure everything's squared away. Let them know what time you plan and where you plan and all that, and they'll take care of it. You'll be fine.
Cool. And I know that there was a link to that. It's on the handout for this exact one because Paul found a great place from the FAA that talks about this information as well. But I absolutely agree. The flight service one is a great option when trying to file these flight plans and you need help. The last question we had for international flight ops was just this person was asking, they were trying to go down to Mexico. They were looking for a world aeronautical chart or sectional for all of Baja printed, not electronic. Ooh. They were wondering where to get them. Can you help us out with that, Paul?
You're not going to find a current one. For as far as I know, the last thing I saw was Mexico was looking at updating their chart in 2016. And that's the last I heard of it. So chances are if you do find one, it's going to be out of date. And your best option is to go electronic. Otherwise, I don't know if you'd be able to find one. It's just they don't exist anymore.
All right. There it is. And so and I know he's definitely one on this because this is what those folks handle. All right. Quick question on this one, which was this person unfortunately had their logbook, their pilot logbook. It was at a flying club that they were a part of, and they had 2,000 plus hours. It was PIC, and the flying club officer or the hangar, whatever, had a fire that happened, and their logbooks were destroyed, and they wanted to know how to go about trying to rebuild some of that record? And I know, Paul, you get this kind of question in the PIC all the time, so can you tell us what the steps are here to follow?
Yeah, I mean, if you can prove it, you can use it. The only problem is you're going to lose all your endorsements as far as flight reviews and tailwheel and all that other stuff. But if you got to try to substantiate it. So from aircraft records, insurance records, past 8710s that you filled out, medicals, things you filled out for your insurance company, any of that kind of stuff to substantiate your time is perfect. But you really got to, it's kind of like losing logbooks for an aircraft. You got to be able to prove you're current. That's the main thing you've got to prove. So.
And again, you can get those 8710s from the FAA and going and getting those old records. This is a good point, too, to say, if you're not scanning, taking photos or some kind of electronic record of your logbook, you might want to go do that in some form or another. Scan it for a PDF or whatever so you have another copy of it, or make photocopies or whatever it might be, so you have some sort of a second record of these so you don't lose all of that. And then the last one, Paul, this is our last question before we can get to the Q&A finally. You provided this information. So if you want to find some kind of question from the FAA, you're trying to get a definitive answer from them, tell us about this source that you're aware of.
So this is primarily for instrument approach plates, even airport diagrams and the like. But it's called the IFP Information Gateway, or Instrument Flight Procedures Information Gateway. You can go in there. You can look up the charts for the airport. One of the questions we get probably half a dozen times a year is, why is this less accurate type of approach, let's say an LMAV approach, why is the minimum lower for it than, say, a LPV approach? And the answer is, we don't know. You'd have to ask the FAA, because there could be obstacles. It could be any number of things. That's what this IFP Information Gateway is for, because the people that are responsible for flight testing and designing these procedures get these emails. So they can vary. I've never had one take more than 2 days. They usually turn around and answer your question and say, well, it's because of an obstacle, or it's this, or it's that. So they can actually give you a definitive answer of why.
Cool. And then I know that with the FAA too, that they have other things too. I've seen, and maybe it's just the different departments that they've got, but you can ask them directly. I had a question about, I think it was the Airman Registry database. And so I there was an email at the bottom and it said you can email them. And they did get back to me within a couple of days. So you can contact them directly.
Yeah. You don't always have to try to go through the FISDO. And sometimes the FISDOs don't know. So.
Cool.
Hey, all so right. Chris, let me ask some of these questions too, because we're 7 minutes into our 30-minute Q&A that I've promised people.
Here's the code, by the way, for the AOPA pilot passport while we're doing
that. Oh, yes. The pilot passport.
ICF Web 032422 or March
24th, 2022. Cool. So, yeah, some people aren't very happy that we only had those three hats. So I apologize. People, those three hats. They're not happy. Okay. all right. I got one here. Can I fly from the US to Mexico VFR without having to check in? If I don't land, I'm just sightseeing.
So you're going to cross the border. You're going to be crossing
an international border.
Yeah, and crossing an aid is. I've been vectored across going into El Paso once, and I was talking to ATC. I wouldn't try it. You're crossing an international border. You're penetrating an aid is. I don't know how the Mexican authorities are going to like it. And that particular border is under surveillance all the time. So you may get a friendly visit from a King Air citation from U.S. Customs. So you need to be on a flight plan. I know, guys, you could do a flight over. You need to be talking. You need to be on the screen. You want people to know what you're doing around the border, or you're going to get unwanted attention.
Right. So in other words, the recommendation is no. Please don't do that.
Yeah, I mean, it's an international border, right? I mean, we wouldn't drive across it without, it's the same thing.
Oh, right, especially that border.
Exactly. All right, so here's a flight following question. How do you request flight following if the test is not straight? For example, KFDK, KLG, I don't know what that is, and KOXB. Do you request OXB to AILG or something else? We had another couple of these too, which is if you're stopping somewhere, do you just request origin, destination, or do you tell them you want every stop in between?
So when you're requesting flight following, tell them it's not like you're following a flight plan. You're asking for an on-demand service, and they may drop you. So if you're going to be flying to a place for lunch and then flying from there to another, you're not following a flight plan. You're just requesting help. So if you request, they're going to say, where are you going and what altitude? And you tell them, and they'll take care of the rest. But don't, it's kind of like on initial call out. Don't just verbally dump everything. Just right. Tell them you have a request. Tell them you want flight following from Frederick to Martinsburg, whatever it ends up being, and be done with it.
Exactly. And in fact, and the only thing I would say is that it's like, if you're going to stop somewhere, then just ask where you're going to stop. And you can tell them before you land, like, oh, by the way, I'm going to be departing back out of here. Do I just call you on this frequency to pick it back up on my way out? And then the other thing you could do is, like, sometimes you end up making maybe you've got a plan to make a dog leg around. You're not going to go direct straight. So you might tell them that I'd like to request it going to Frederick to Harrisburg, and then I'll be going via the Westminster VOR or something like that. So just give them, because that, otherwise they will ask you, like, why aren't you flying straight? And so that'll just kind of cut that out. And gauge it by how busy they are too. If they're crazy busy, don't worry about all that. Just do what you need to do.
Yeah.
They're not going to care as much. So, okay.
Cool. All right. That's the other flight plan. All right. I have a light sport pilot license issued in Italy. May I validate in the U.S.? Thanks.
Do you know that one, Paul? I don't know the answer to that one.
So yeah. There's a couple things here. I don't believe they will do a conversion for light sport. I know they will do private, and they will do private instrument with U.S. test passed. I can't imagine ICAO or Italy not being an ICAO subscribing country. So it means that any of the flight training that you got in Italy and all the flight time you've got can be used towards a FAA certificate. But long story short, I don't believe you can use your light sport license from another country to validate. It just won't work. Could be wrong, but at the very least, you can use your flight time and qualify. A light sport license is only 20 hours. So it's very much
something. Or...
Yeah, take a check ride and take a written and you'll be done.
Okay.
Cool. All right. So way back in 97, I let my flight instructor certificate expire. Bad move. He knows.
Yeah, I've done it once.
What could I expect in order to reinstate my certificate?
Well, it's a reinstatement. It's a check ride. You're going to need to go with a designated pilot examiner or a safety inspector at the FISDO. Mm-hmm. Probably the former. It's going to cost you some money. You're going to have to get spooled back up. Everything that's going to be covered on the check ride is actually in the PTS for the CFI. They're not an ACS yet. There's actually a table in there.
And the cool thing is, because I had to do this because I was a dummy. And so when I did it, you only have to pass one of your certificates. So I had my instrument multi and my regular CFI. And so I just did my regular CFI. And so that's what they test about.
And that's another thing. If you don't have an MEI, or you don't have a double I, or you don't have a CFIG, and you want to get an instructor rating in that, getting a new instructor rating activates everything else.
Oh, cool. So, that's a good idea.
Some people like to do that because you're not redoing the same thing you've already earned. You're getting something extra.
Cool. That's a good tip. Yeah,
that is a good tip. That's why we're here. Look, if we can just help one person.
This is why we brought Paul on too, because he knows a lot of stuff.
Paul knows a lot of stuff. All right, so we've had many people, just as an FYI, say that you can fly from Canada to the U.S. without approval, as long as you're talking to ATC. That's what they've said. I don't stand behind it or for it. I'm just saying. Okay. Hey, you know, those are the kind of things you do. Okay, so that's the way back when. Are these slides available to review later, Stephen, Chris?
We can probably make a PDF of it. So yeah, we'll see what we can do about that. Maybe post it with the YouTube thing, Stephen.
Yes, I have it as a PDF. If you email me at ftinitiative@aopa.org, I can send you a copy. I do also put them available online, and there's a link to them in on the YouTube channel when we post the video afterwards.
So that's FT Initiative, all spelled out, at AOPA.org. FT Foxtrot Tango.
Ooh, fantastic. All right, so someone's asking about holding patterns to the right, and they read that the standard holding pattern to the right is due to right of way. Yes or no?
It's one of those things. It's one of those things where you'd have to go back in the Federal Register and see what the arguments were, and it may not even be something from the FAA. It might be from the CAA. Mm-hmm. So it's one of those things where, at the end of the day, I believe that, okay, that's a valid answer. It may be the right one, it may be the wrong one, but the fact remains they're the directions they are. So it's really, at this point, a trivia fact. So,
yeah, okay, and I can see, I can see how that could be a valid, reason, but we can't confirm.
Well, you know, there's open interpretations for everything, isn't there? Okay.
I want to put it this way. Can't confirm it. Can't confirm it.
That's right. Let's ask the senator from Chicago. Yeah, vote twice. Okay. With the new ruling about not needing multiple nav sources for the IFR check ride, can I now do a check ride with GPS only?
Go ahead, Paul.
So you've got to be able to demonstrate, because the ruling that you're talking about is for the instrument check, or not the instrument check ride, that is for the cross country.
Yeah. So
the fact remains you have to be able to demonstrate everything. You can't limit yourself. Every area of operation needs to be demonstrated. So the best thing I can think of is talk to your designated pilot examiner beforehand, because all pilot examiners have been given the penalty of death, if you do a check ride that you weren't supposed to do, or you do something wrong, we're going to nail you to the wall. So the best thing to do is talk to the DPE, make sure that they're comfortable with doing it, because there's a lot of DPEs out there that have the opinion, the old opinion. So you got to sometimes educate the DPEs too. So the best thing is make sure you can do every area of operation and talk to the DPE and then figure it out from there. But it's not something you want to show up to a check ride and say, oh, by the way, I have no VOR. I have no ability to do an ILS. We're just going to be doing GPS approaches today. Chances are that DPE is going to turn around and say, well, thanks for your fee. We're going to go ahead and not do this check ride today.
Right.
So it's not one of these things you want to ask for permission, not beg for forgiveness, because it's too hard to get a check ride nowadays anyways.
And one of the things I just want to throw in there too is just to clarify, there is the letter of interpretation in there that Paul's very familiar with, this one that says on the instrument cross country during our training, there's a required, we'll call it a long cross country, where you've got to do three different approaches. Now that it used to be where you had to do GPS, VOR, and ILS under the old system, or NDB or something like that. Now you can do two GPS approaches, and you just have three different types. But don't forget during the check ride too that you, anything that's installed in the aircraft, you've got to be able to do. So make sure you're proficient with whatever's in that airplane.
Sure your mechanic is good with placarding things right before check ride.
We cannot say things like that, Paul.
It's a joke. It's a joke.
So, okay. I think this one answers itself. So maybe I'm reading it wrong, and maybe you guys will actually understand what it says. IFR currency regulation states that in the preceding 6 months, for example, does that mean if I'm in the seventh month, I'm still okay?
So you got to be able to look back 6 months from your flight. Best thing to do is, I hate when guys do it piecemeal. They're like, in February I did two, and the next month I did one, and then I did a hold. So pull out a calendar, mark out when you did approaches. If you can count back your preceding 6 months, and you're good. But I hate saying, oh, you know, you're in the seventh month. No. It's the preceding 6 months. There is no hard, fast rule to this. You need to pull out a calendar. You need to count back 6 months. And that's the best way of doing it.
The other thing,
Paul, is talk to the day, though, right? So, for example, if you were January 12th, you don't have to look back to July 12th, right? It's July 1st.
So it's in the preceding calendar months. So let me... Yeah. This one I always have to pull out a calendar, because it's so difficult to say, you know. So if you want to, we can do an example. Let's say, what are we in? We're in March. So let's say you did the right thing, and you decided to do all of your approaches at one shot and kept yourself current. Or let's say you did an IPC.
Right.
Let's say you did the IPC in September. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So yeah, let's say you did an IPC in September, or you did your 6 approaches in September. If you count back the preceding 6 months, you got February, January, December, November, October. So, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in the preceding 6 months, you're good because you did an IPC 6 months preceding the date of the flight or the month of the flight. But you, best thing to do is pull out a calendar.
Because, the other thing, if I could add in here too, though, is that playing this game to me is really dangerous, because if that's what you've done, it's been 6 months, I'm going to tell you that while you might legally be current, I'm going to say that I'm 99% sure that you're probably not proficient, because I know for me, I've got a good bit of instrument experience and it gets rusty really quick. So this is probably not a smart idea to be trying to say, well, I can legally go fly IFR now. Well, you legally might be able to, but you're putting yourself into a lot of risk here. Much better to go practice some approaches and get yourself proficient again before you decide you want to go file, or even more so fly in IMC for real. So really be careful with that kind of stuff. That doesn't seem to me to be a great aeronautical decision making there.
Yeah, there's legal and then there's proficient. Yeah. And then there's legal and then there's smart. And right. Pushing things to the very end of things is not a smart idea.
Yep. So anyway, just my my advice sounds like Paul's too. So all right, go ahead.
Cool. If my 2-year BFR, I'll change the FR just for our sakes, time frame ends before I get the review done, are there any issues or concerns I need to take care of before flying with a CFI to do the review?
I'll put it this way. You can do a flight review, have any expired medical, and have any expired flight review. One of you needs to be PIC. So your instructor needs to be current with flight review, and they have to have a medical depending on what type of plane you're flying and basic med and all that fun stuff. But essentially, you do not need to act as PIC on a flight review. And there are no penalties for letting your flight review expire other than you can't act as PIC. But you're going to have an instructor with you, so you're fine. You can still log a PIC on a flight review as sole manipulator as well. So there's no penalty. You could still log PIC on a flight review, even if you're out of currency.
Yeah, because you're properly rated and all that good stuff.
Yep.
In fact, just to give you the throw it on, that our Rusty Pilots program is exactly what happens. You could do some ground training, get yourself up to speed, and then you could do a flight review 20 years, 30 years later. And it's, yeah, absolutely, you can go do a flight review. Just plan on the farther out it is, that it might take you a little longer. Don't think you're just going to go up, fly for an hour and have it be done. Probably not going to happen. And nor would that likely be a good idea. Yeah, probably not.
Interesting. Asking for a friend, have a Canadian private license and not flown in the U.S. Is there any special requirement for review or currency? I think it's probably more than just those questions.
So they're Canadian private pilot. They have no U.S. certificate and they haven't flown in a while?
Well, it says, is there just a requirement for review or currency? So I'm guessing it is because they haven't flown in a while.
Okay. So number one, couple things here. If you're looking to get a conversion in the U.S., the license it's based off has to be current. So if you're trying to turn your Canadian license into a U.S. license, there's even an advisory circular for changing a U.S. into a Canadian. I forget what the number of it is, though. But there is a special process for Canadian and FAA certificates to be converted either way. As far as flying here in the U.S., are you going to be flying a Canadian registered aircraft here? It sounds like he's not current. So number one, you got to get current, and be legal. And then a lot of the times, like I can't go with my U.S. license and fly a Canadian registered aircraft in Canada. I can only fly an N registered aircraft with an FAA certificate. So, I would hope you'd be flying a Canadian registered aircraft here unless you have an FAA certificate. And if you do have an FAA certificate based on your Canadian, the FAA certificate is not valid if your Canadian license is not current. And some countries even have a requirement that their licenses will expire if you don't stay current. So there's all sorts of weird stuff, but even if you have an FAA based on your foreign, if the foreign's no good, the FAA is no good.
By the way, you can clearly tell that how much the breadth of information that Paul knows. So I just put the slide back up for our Pilot Information Center. Got questions like this and you want to get them answered, contact them, 1-800-USA-AOPA and that pilot assistant AOPA.org. These guys know a ton of stuff and we didn't even touch on medical stuff at all. So.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Okay. Hold on, where is it? There it is. Okay, does having a special issuance medical prevent the pilot from easing into LSA after it expires?
So the requirement for both basic med and light sport, and I assume what we're talking about is exercising light sport privileges. The requirement there is that your most recent medical could not have been denied, revoked, or suspended. So if you just let your special issuance expire, it's not one of those three things. So you could actually go into light sport. The most important thing is if you apply for an FAA medical and you get deferred or there's a special issuance, if they request extra information from you and you don't respond, they'll deny you for failure to provide. So the best thing for you to do if you're planning on doing this, give the PIC a call, talk to our medical staff, make sure you're on the straight and narrow, because the last thing you want to do is if you want to drop your special issuance, you get roped into doing it again. Because that could be thousands of dollars. I mean, that could be the cost of a new car. So make sure you got your ducks in a line and give us a call. That's what we're here for. Yep.
Okay, cool. People talking about logbooks, PPL licenses. Okay, 4 minutes left. Oh, geez, a lot of baseball cap stuff. Getting caught in the questions here. So I'm currently flying a Cessna 172, but getting ready to switch to a Piper Archer. Bravo, great move.
Oh, that's a poor decision making right there.
Is there, medium, is there a really big difference switching from high wing to low wing?
Yes. I flew the Pipers and the Diamonds a lot, and I've got thousands of hours in 172s. You will find yourself, especially if you're used to Cessnas, going into turns and trying to look above the wing if you've got skylights in your 172. So it's just, you got to remember the wing's in a different position. I like the way Pipers land. It's really visual. Yes. That's all it is. Landings are a lot better in a Piper in high winds, as far as I'm concerned. That's just my opinion. But they fly pretty much the same. It's just, you got to remember there's little nuances. And then the big thing is visual. Looking outside and having a wing in your way when you're coming into land, you don't have it in your way for other things, but that's the major thing. It's no big deal.
I do feel like, because I've got most of my time in Cessnas and I've flown Pipers a bit, I feel like there's the ground effect feels a little different in between the two of them as well when you're coming into land, but they're not I don't find them that much different though.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm gonna go Cessna because Paul's going Piper, so just throw it out there.
I like the arrows, but the other thing is the yoke, especially for like soft field takeoffs. The yokes, you pull full back, and then you got to pull up on the Pipers to get full extension on the elevator.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I remember that.
So it's if you're a taller guy or you're a bigger guy, you got to make sure that you can get that yoke all the way back because Cessna's a whole got a lot more space, whereas the Pipers have a little bit more throw to them.
I like the wings better on the, or not the wings, yeah, flaps.
That's true. But, those are cool. I admit the Piper's got the right thing there.
And the extra 3 degrees during a power of 180 doesn't hurt either.
That's right. Okay. All right. In a plane like a basic 152, when it says you'll get a particular performance at a particular percentage of power, how do you determine what percentage of power you're using?
Well, it's based off RPM.
Yeah. Hey, just look at the chart and the temperature.
Well, and the other thing you got to realize, just like takeoff and landing data, cruise performance is based on a perfect day with a test pilot in a brand new aircraft.
And lean just right.
Yeah. So
not a 40-year-old aircraft?
Yeah. Or a 50-year-old aircraft with a 3-time overhauled engine.
And a 10,000-hour frame. Okay. Finishing my instrument training, want to get a multi-engine rating. One instructor said get the commercial rating. Another said if I was flying privately, skip the commercial, go straight to multi. Thoughts?
Yeah, I remember our school was playing with this idea because I did my commercial first, then did the multi, and then later they went to doing the multi commercial first because there's less to do on it, and then did the single engine add on later. So I don't know, Paul, do you have any, you did it at Embry-Riddle. How did you guys do it there?
So I did it what I thought was the smartest way. I went all the way through my double I. I figured I'd be more on point and waste less time, and then did my multi-commercial add-on. Okay. It all depends on what you want to do. You're not going to be soloing. You're not going to get any more PIC time. If you're really looking to pick up multi-time, I'd do private, then do private multi-add-on. And that way, every time you fly, even with an instructor in a multi from that point forward, you're logging PIC time. So if your concern is PIC time, do it that way. If money's not a concern, heck, go ahead and do a commercial multi. But the problem is add-on is train to proficiency and sign off when you're staying within the same category. The problem is if you do an initial commercial multi, that's expensive. That's okay. Really expensive. And you're building all those hours. I mean, an add-on should be 18 or less hours. At $300 or $400 an hour, that's still a lot of money.
Yeah. And you know what? You're right now that I'm thinking back to it because I did my single commercial first and then did the multi add-on. And if you're able to focus and you're studious and everything else and get your procedures down ahead of time, it doesn't take that long to add on the multi. It's not that. It's less than 20 hours, I think. It's probably even less than that. On average, so you can do it if you're really good about it, and use a sim to help with it and stuff too. So
yeah, and cool. What you're gonna realize that $300 an hour, that's $5 a minute.
Yeah, it's expensive.
Chris, take us to the end slide, please, with our next presentation.
You got it. Let's go. Thanks, quickly.
So the time has come and gone. We're 12:31. We've broken my first rule, which is don't go past 30 minutes, and we're 31 minutes. So that was fun. It went quick. Paul, really appreciate you coming out. It was fantastic. I love your prison cell background. Let's do that again later. Yeah. And April 21st, next episode, next month, 12 to 1 Eastern or 11 to 12:30 Central. It's 30 minutes longer from the Central time zone. Now you see, now you don't. The bad magic of VFR into IMC with special guest stars from ASI. That's right. The Safety Institute will be here with
That's
us.
That's right. John Collins will be here with us.
After presentation. So, Paul, thanks again. Chris, fantastic. So you want to play us out?
I'll try. We'll see if the microphone will work.
Remember, when you're calling into to PIC, if you get hold of Paul, he loves questions about basic med and flight instructor refresher courses. Those are his favorite.
Stephen, thank you for spinning the wheels of steel in the background, and to everybody, I'm sorry we couldn't get to all your questions, but thank you, and we'll see you next month. Even.
It's not working.